So we now start with two short inputs. One will be given by Leo Panitch, who is going to start. I don't hesitate to call him the Dean of the Canadian Left. And Rachelle LaForest, who is the Executive Director of the Right to the City Alliance. Okay, the floor is yours, Leo.
Thanks, Albert. First of all, let me congratulate the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung people in New York for undertaking this remarkable event, bringing together the North American left in a way that it hasn't been brought together before. I think they deserve a lot of credit for this. I would rather pick up from where we left off last night, and especially talk about what one of the people who spoke from the floor referred to in terms of how do we scale up, which seems to me the crucial thing we want to be addressing this weekend. That said, I've been asked not to do that, but I will segue into it. And talk about the state of neoliberalism in order to set up a contrast between the ideology and practice of neoliberalism and the conception and the practice of a notion of the commons, which seems to me worth doing as well. So I think you see some of the comments I sent, but the way the question was put was it would be good if you could address the intellectual bankruptcy of neoliberalism and contrast that with the fact that it is very much a living vampire, very much still in practice, even though it is intellectually bankrupt. And I said, as you'll see in my notes, that this is really just an apparent contradiction. And I want to say that it seems to me that intellectually and ideologically, even ideologically in a popular sense, neoliberalism has been tarnished for a very, very long time, long preceding the crisis of 2006, that began in 2007, 2008. You could at least say, you know, it begins with Seattle, but in fact, you can go well before that. There was an element even to Clinton's election in 1992, remember, you know, it's the economy, stupid. You hardly would call Robert Reich a neoliberal, even though he's oriented to progressive competitiveness. And you know, Clinton was doing a lot of running on a Reichian program until, of course, he got into office and Reich got trapped in the cabinet, et cetera. But so I don't know that we should look at neoliberalism in terms so much of it being triumphant intellectually or ideologically. And if one tries to think instead about what is it then, I prefer to avoid the notion that neoliberalism is this very well thought through philosophy from Hayek or von Mises or whoever, or Friedman, which the bourgeoisie carries around in its head and then instructs policymakers or the state to introduce. I think that's an idealist conception. I think that the people who run the capitalist states are very pragmatic people. They're not primarily ideologically driven, and they aren't primarily told by the bourgeoisie what to do. They do have to manage a capitalist state which is dependent on the accumulation of capital, on national competition, et cetera, et cetera. But they're fundamentally not ideologically driven. So what is it? And, you know, I tried to set out, since I was asked to do this, four different definitions that I think make some sense. One, it can be defined as a set of policies, which would then still need to be explained in terms of why those become adopted and when they become adopted. Taxation structures that favor capital accumulation over income redistribution. Industrial policies that minimize the presence of the state and private industry. Retrenchment of welfare spending. that type of set of policies. You could look upon neoliberalism as strategic, and that's how David Harvey, for instance, does, tending to, this is in the heads of the bourgeoisie, they have a strategy, the state carries it out, and probably best defined, as it is by him, as a program for class power based on the ideology of free market utopia. And Naomi Klein is very close to this as well. You could do it as the balance of class forces in the context of capitalist social relations in a capitalist state. And in that sense, the central role of financial capital, the growing international global production networks, the defeat of trade unionism since the early 1980s, right across the advanced capitalist countries, and to some extent, even in the global south, in certain countries in the global south, amounts to a capitalism, as Adolf Reed and Mark Dudzik put it in the current volume of the Socialist Register, amounts to a capitalism that has effectively eliminated working class opposition. And that's how they define neoliberalism. Which means that you can find, and Sam Gindin and I tried to look at it this way, you can find neoliberalism in the welfare state, but in the context of a different set of, a different balance of class forces. A practice during the period of the welfare state, which still involved the deepening and spreading of capitalist social relations, but in the context of a different balance of class forces, that had to be done in a somewhat different way. So commodification, the dependence of the vast majority of the population on, for their subsistence on purchasing private commodities, goes on through the welfare state. In fact, you could say the welfare state and Keynesianism are largely about providing the income to those people who otherwise would not have the means to buy private commodities. It was not so much the provision of collective services, least of all in this country, of course. Right. And then you could finally, and this is how Greg Albo has defined neoliberalism, I think most consistently for the last 20 years, as a state form, as a particular type of capitalist state form. A different kind of state, if you like. And what's most important here, and I hear, I think that people have engaged in miseducation, people on the left, whether they've done it as academics, and most academics have engaged in this miseducation, or a great many social activists, have treated neoliberalism as a matter of deregulation, as less state, as the withdrawal of the state, as bypassing of the state by capital. It's not the case. Neoliberalism involves a very, very active state, involved in an enormous amount of regulation in order to establish market relations more deeply and more widely across the globe. It's a very, very active state. Of course, it involves a transformation in some of the roles that departments of labor, departments of welfare previously played. Right. But even welfare agencies, insofar as they're no longer providing as much income maintenance as they used to, when you end welfare as you know it, you still have very, very active welfare agencies ensuring that people are entering into labor markets at wages where they're able to compete with Vietnamese women working on a dollar a day or what have you. So it in no sense has involved a diminution of the state, and it's been one of the ways in which the left has miseducated, it seems to me, activists, including the left, which used to treat the welfare state as an agency of social control, in this period has turned around and treated neoliberalism as the mirror image of the welfare state, as though the welfare state was still not a capitalist state, as though it was a working class state in some sense. And I think this has been extremely harmful and extremely misleading, and it's led to people being suspicious of the left because their own experience of the capitalist state, even during the welfare state period, was an alienating one, right? Women dependent on income maintenance didn't see the welfare agencies as their own. They saw them as policing them, right? So I think we've, in some senses, undermined ourselves in the way we've treated neoliberalism in this way. Now, we've also, I think, tended to tremendously overemphasize the consistency of neoliberalism in the post-crisis period. Constantly, we see people saying that since 2008, you've had nothing but austerity. It's actually not the case. In 2009, you had the greatest fiscal stimulus in this country in peacetime history, ever. And you had, through the G20, a coordinated fiscal stimulus, which was enormous. Now, the consequences of that, of course, were a large deficit, especially in the context of falling taxation revenues due to the downturn the economy, the massive recession that came with the crisis. So you didn't have a consistency. On the contrary, you had an attempt, and had there not been that attempt, we would indeed have seen depression-level unemployment. What the U.S. Treasury calls, and has called since the 90s, because they know how fragile and chaotic and irrational this system is, and yet how important this financialized global capitalism is to greasing the wheels of international production, right? They have spoken in terms of failure containment. We aren't engaged in the business of failure prevention, because that undermines the dynamic of the system, the innovation in the system. But we know that there are failures, we know there are crises. These guys are not neoclassical economists who think you always return to equilibrium. They don't believe that for a minute, right? But they're engaged in failure containment. And the failure containment in 2009 was to engage in this fiscal stimulus. The consequences of doing so are a large deficit, of course, and in the context of the balance of class forces, I don't have to tell you here what happened after the 2010 congressional election and the effect that had in terms of limiting the room for maneuver for continuing some sort of fiscal stimulus, which most of the Clintonite Democrats economists want to do, right? In Europe, you've had fiscal austerity imposed along the same lines that the 1980s debt crisis imposed through structural adjustment on those countries who became dependent on it to get back into bond markets. And the logic of that is primarily the power that bond markets have, including the pension funds of trade unions. The power that bond markets have over any country that is dependent on the sale of its bonds internationally in bond markets. Now, there's of course, austerity has been, in that context, very powerful and severe. But on the other hand, the kind of what one would expect of neoliberalism from its origins would have been a very strict and tight monetary policy of the type the German Bundesbank that the Rosa Luxemburg people know so well prognosticates. In fact, we've had a monetary policy which has been extremely lax. Right, a monetary policy which has involved throwing liquidity into the international system. It's been that again in the context of fiscal austerity after 2010, which has contained the failure. Right. And that too needs to be taken into account if we're at all seriously talking about the form that neoliberalism is taking. The reason it still deserves to be called neoliberalism is not just the austerity, is because the practice of the G20 states, of course, led by the American Empire, and very much with the US Treasury and Federal Reserve at the center, having brought together the leaders of the G20 for the first time in Washington in October 2008, the first time it wasn't just the finance ministers of the G20 met, but the leaders. Since 2008, and it's the Treasury that writes these communiques, all of those leaders, including Russia and South Africa and Brazil and China, have repeatedly signed on to keeping neoliberal globalization going. They have committed to sustain the types of policies, above all the free movement of capital, above all free trade, right, as their primary commitment. They would not, in other words, let this crisis lead them back to the types of policies that 1930s depression produced, which was high tariffs, very extensive restrictions on the free movement of capital, et cetera. And they have more or less sustained that, including each of the BRICS, and would do so through this new BRIC bank, although it'll give them some room for maneuver vis-a-vis international capital markets. I've run out of time. I just want to gesture in the context of what does this mean strategically for the left. It seems to me that given the nature of this form of state, given the balance of class forces almost everywhere, not least within the BRICS, where the working class is also either defeated or integrated for the most part, although there are stirrings, of course, most excitingly at the moment in NUMSA and South Africa, to some extent in the strike waves in China. But it seems to me there is very, very little room for reform within this type of capitalist state. The only way one can imagine getting a set of state policies that would lead us out of this would involve the types of reforms that at a minimum would turn the financial system of each country into a public utility. You probably can no longer have capital controls without them. Right. You'd have to have decommodification in many areas of social life. And the question we need to pose to ourselves, and I want to ask, end with this, and I think this is the only reason one wants to talk about, is our form of organization adequate, do we have the types of parties and movements which are capable of putting that agenda to people, to giving them a sense that there is an alternative to neoliberal capitalism. And I do think we need to speak much more in terms of capitalism than in neoliberalism. And people don't have that sense, and when they don't have that sense, when they don't have, they are given no strategic vision, then they try to hold on to whatever little toehold they have within this system, usually at the expense of the other, which is why we see the rise of the extreme right to this extent. It becomes extremely important, therefore, to ask ourselves whether we have the form of self-organization to be able to talk to people in a way that helps us understand better what neoliberalism capitalism is, and to seriously talk about what type of state can change it. We can protest until the cows come home. Unless we're able to enter the state, right, we will protest till the end of time. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Albert says I need no introduction. Good morning. I love you guys in the front. So I too want to riff off the thread that began and that we started to dig into last night, but we'll try to pepper it into some of the comments that I make this morning. So I was asked to think about and present some material for discussion around the paradigm of the commons as a possible strategic vehicle toward the end that Leo just mentioned, in terms of how we are structuring ourselves, our organizations, how we're actually moving and realizing an alternative in the midst of the market paradigm and the neoliberal state that we live in. Albert mentioned earlier, I'm the executive director of Right to the City Alliance. I prefer to usually say that I'm privileged to be a part of Right to the City Alliance because I was not its birth parent and I'm learning so much, you know, through the times that I've come on. We are a national alliance of grassroots organizations throughout the United States, and there are actually many Right to the City movements happening throughout Europe and other parts of the world. So we are a collective of grassroots organizations that are led primarily, and in instances where it doesn't happen really truly do strive to be led by the bases that make up our member organizations. So our communities are the chief decision makers and drivers of the work that we do most of the time through our individual organizations, and then to a large extent in how Right to the City moves its work. And I feel like the way that we are organized and the way that we move our work has a lot of synergy with being able to establish and plant some roots with regard to this commons paradigm. And so I just want to talk a little bit about how we see and define the commons and think through whether or not there is a relationship or examine what the relationship between the commons and socialism is. So for us, you know, we see the commons as clearly, I think we all probably have a solid working definition that it is a shared space and resources to reinvent or reprioritize the way that we work and live as a society. We see the commons as really the foundation. A commons paradigm or a commons movement is the foundation for any kind of anti-capitalist or anti-colonial program that's going to move forward. And that having the conversations and organizing through the paradigm of the commons is exactly the vehicle or the host site through which folks can begin to realize and understand an alternative to what we currently have. A very important piece, I think, for us about the commons is that we see it as something not exclusive only to those who can pay for entry, you know? So the way that capitalism or neoliberalism has been able to sort of commodify the use of the term or integrate the commons into the way the market gets run is that they've recognized that there's far less chaos and pushback if there are certain resources like the seas or forests, national forests that become conservation, you know, parks. If there's this pseudo collective public control of these places and spaces, that there's a very effective use of this notion of the commons within that right. And that's actually the opposite of the way that we see the commons needing to play out, because it's this pseudo public ownership. You know, it is actually not, these are not actually not places or resources or functions that belong to the people or to communities. So it's not for people who can pay for access, and it's also not this pseudo-socialist place for people who are able to show up, right? So one of the things in preparing for this, I had a few conversations with my comrades about, you know, let's talk about the commons, like let's really break this thing down. And I had one very good conversation examining Occupy, which, you know, we love and are also critical of and need to be. Occupy became a commons-like space, but for the people who could show up to it, right? And so the mic checks and the decision-making and the way that power got built through Occupy happened through the people who actually were able to be present in those spaces. And in New York, I remember having conversations with some of our member groups, groups of color who had were very excited about what was happening down at Liberation Park, down at Zuccotti Park, and walked away having really hard, horrible experiences, you know, feeling like lab rats of sorts, you know, that people were talking about the state of their lives, the state of their worlds, who they were, what their whole story was, as if they were lab rats, you know, or something in a petri dish, as opposed to real living human beings. And so it's one of the most important characteristics of the commons for us is that the people who are most directly impacted by the neoliberal state, by the market paradigm, are the central decision makers, whether they can show up physically to the space or not. And that the commons have to be organized in a way that brings their realities, that brings their ideas, that brings their passions and their needs to the central part of decision making above anything else. So that's an important distinction that I just want to put out. We also are clear that it's not, I mean, I mentioned this before, the commons is not something that is developed purely to sort of create some nuanced alternative to the market. You know, oh, but look, we have this pretty common thing over here. Look, this public park over here, right? We're sharing. This is this belongs to the public. And something I think that I hadn't really thought about prior to being in Right to the City, even though I had lots of experience with it in function, and it goes back to this notion of scale. It is actually the question of scale with regard to the commons. I think for us, when we look at common processes or vehicles that are able to be structured and actually run really well, they're very small, actually, in scale, and they're very localized. And so we talk a lot in Right to the City about small, localized economies. That's not to say that they exist in a vacuum. I think that there's a huge degree of importance for there to be high levels of connectivity and shared ideas and shared models and connecting that happens. We use the term translocally, and we actually organize our work translocally so that the place-based fights that our groups are having are highly connected to other cities, to what our groups are doing in other cities. So it's really important that any commons, the realization of commons functions and mechanisms not exist in vacuums and be highly connected, not only throughout the US, but throughout the world, so that they're not these small little, again, nuanced enclaves of diversity, but that they actually are become something that is larger than the sum of its parts. I wanna talk a little bit about, I think I started to talk a little bit about how this shows up in our work. But I want to both discuss how this shows up in our work and then some of the challenges that we've been having with moving a commons framework. So our campaign work is organized both in the pursuit of immediate reforms that will provide direct relief and immediate relief to ourselves and our communities, but also coupled with transformative demands and longer term visioning and thinking about what alternative replacements are wholly to those functions or pieces of the system that are not serving our community's needs. So an example would be where we are deeply entrenched in moving a national housing campaign right now that began in the aftermath of the foreclosure crisis and that we've now expanded to really look at the question of affordability and the commodification of land and housing in general. And so there are, you know, we've got a lawsuit going against the FHFA, Federal Housing and Financing Agency, sorry, no alphabet city. And at the same time are working to have that lawsuit parcel out pieces of money that could finance alternative forms of non-market-based housing like community land trusts or limited equity cooperatives. Or we're even exploring with a very close allied organization in New York, Cohabitation Strategies, this hybrid model that actually uses some public funding from the federal, state, or city level and ultimately winds up being able to run off of the rent that tenants would pay into it, keeps it permanently affordable, a portion of the rent goes into escrow so that people are able to build wealth. Thank you, Albert. But so we are both fighting for the immediate relief and then offering and trying to explore and push and even pilot in some places alternatives so that our communities actually can be able to engage in and construct and visualize and live through the alternative. And you know, I used this anecdote before and people thought it was quite interesting, so I'll share it here too. We are highly critical, both internally, you know, of ourselves as leftists, our own organization, and of the left broadly, of really being unable to visualize an alternative to a market-based system that feels vibrant and beautiful and healthy and fresh and fun and loving to our communities. You know, it's in the way that we talk about, from my experience, in the way that we talk about the alternative, for many people, it looks like, in their imagination, the Nebuchadnezzar from the Matrix, right? Everyone is wearing gray and brown, dowdy clothing, and it's cold, and the mush for breakfast, lunch, and dinner is coming out of this machine, and it's just miserable. And we're failing if that is the image that we're providing as the alternative, if that's what our commons looks like for people. Or for my daughter, for example, who's 17 years old, and her only notion of Haiti or any place in the global south are small villages with dirt roads and no running water. And, you know, and for her, when I say the commons, that's what she thinks about. And actually, that's not what it has to look like at all. We have incredible amounts of resources and technology and creativity at our disposal where we can create a commons-based society that is comfortable and beautiful and joyful and you know, something that people really enjoy living in and being a part of. And I want to offer, the question about how challenging it is to actually realize that and build that and move it. And our challenge in being able to do that work to actually not just articulate fights against capital or point to some examples of alternative to it, but really build out a visual picture for people. We partnered with Rosa Luxemburg, it's 2 years ago maybe, to do an urban ecologies, an urban encuentro last year. And we had this two-day conference, and the second day was bringing in activists from all issue areas in New York City into the room to reimagine New York City, reimagine it. And we led folks through these breakout exercises where we were asking them to really draw out and explain what their alternative to public housing or private homeownership or the current school system or the current healthcare system was. And there were huge chunks of people in the room who were first really pissed off that we were not creating a deliberate campaign around a very particular target and coming up with tactics to take that target down, and who also really had an impossible time doing what we were asking them to do. You know, and a lot of people said, well, I don't draw, I'm not an artist. Well, you don't have to, like, explain it, sing it to me, you know, write a poem, something. So I feel like that's a failure of ours on the left. And that for Right to the City, we really work to use the commons-based paradigm and these small local projects and pieces of work with each other to do precisely that. Another example of how we try to integrate the alternative into our reform work is through our political education. So our foreclosure groups have been really, really difficult to move in a direction where they would get less equity from their private home than they are planning to, right? And you would imagine for communities of color, home ownership has been one of the primary, if not the only vehicle for building capital in this country. Many of those folks have been foreclosed on, and for the people who are trying to hang on to their homes, they don't want to hear about not being able to recoup what they invested in their little piece of capital. But we do have a political education track around the history of the commodification of land and housing so that people can really understand that the parcel of land that your house sits on doesn't belong to you, and really your house doesn't belong to you. They can come and take it from you at any time if they so choose, you know? But we've really struggled with primarily our foreclosure folks in being able to realize and think about and move beyond this sense of commons, because the American dream of private home ownership and owning your little piece of the pie is so deeply ingrained in our culture and our values that folks can and are very, very scared to move past it. What do I want to?
1 minute.
I have 1 minute left. Thank you, Albert. So going back to the Nebuchadnezzar and not doing that, for us, the realizing the paradigm of the commons is far more about just formulating policies and programs, and really most about tapping into the desires and the imaginations of ourselves and our communities. And so we really work in Right to the City to create space for more thinking. Really encouraging the development of the ideas from our members, not just the staff or even the national staff of Right to the City. And it's tough because it's a far slower process. And as a nonprofit organization, we are up against this question of scale. You know, our foundation, our philanthropic partners measure us against this question of scale with regard to the numbers of people that we are able to turn out to something or sign up for something or move through a training. And there's this real focus on breadth as opposed to depth. And so I want to challenge how we are thinking about and talking about scale. I think it's clearly crucial to move the numbers, but to what end and at what level of depth are we moving our communities and those numbers of people in the pursuit of actually crafting an alternative? It's very easy, let me not say it's very easy for the folks who do electoral work in the room. It is far easier to deliver numbers in the millions around some election that's taking place between two Democrats, right? Obama's race is a perfect example. Our communities came out in droves, and then Obama came in and has been in two terms now, and it's met bupkis. In fact, you know, if you look at what's happening with Gaza, and it's worse than anyone I think could have imagined. So how do we strike the balance between the breadth and achieving that scale and the depth? And it is the depth. And I just want to like give a shout out to the organizing that was called out yesterday, because the organizing is the key and crucial piece of moving beyond the scale of breadth and actually having folks be fighting for and cultivating leadership that will be in the service of the commons, who want to actually build out the commons and the alternatives to this market-based paradigm. It's not happening through Obama, it's not happening through the Democratic Party. There is no viable left party. It's not happening through the Working Families Party. And so what I would offer is that it's going to happen through our communities. We are going to have to take the leadership ourselves to craft the alternatives, whether they be food cooperatives, worker cooperatives, housing cooperatives. We are going to, in some places in the midst of, building out these models as an alternative, a very living, breathing, vibrant example of what exists. But they can very easily be taken down if they're not being built out with significant force and defense behind them. And so with regard to strategy, I want to be able to dig into the relationship between socialism and the commons, the relationship between the state. What is the role of the state in actually fostering a commons-based paradigm? Does it rob us of self-governance and self-organization? How can it step up and aid us in that? And I'm hoping to, with you all and with you, Leo, uncover some of the answers to that. Thank you. Thank you.